Greetings, friends. Just a quick announcement before we get on with the Nighthawk Treasurer video. From me and this little dog here, we wish you an early happy holidays, and this is our Miracle on 1911th Street whiskey that just came out. By the time this video comes out, it will have been out for about a week or so, so I don't know if there will be any left, but I wanted to get the word out to you guys. This is a really more of a passion project than anything for me as a degenerate whiskey drinker and collector. This is about 90% rye, about 10% bourbon, two different single barrels into one barrel that then got finished in a maple syrup barrel. So this is a basically unique blend. This is a unique blend to us that we find to be very tasty. This is not what your actual bottle will look like. This is the prototype that we made down in Texas. But you can go over to the Whiskey Blendery website, order anything you like. It's a 2-bottle maximum per person. We do appreciate the support, but we also think you're really gonna like the juice. So with that said, roll the Nighthawk video.
Am I going to get a bottle or no?
Yeah, maybe. We'll see. We'll see how you do today.
Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. My name is Jake, and I'm a hypocrite. You see, I love 1911s and shoot them the majority of range days. A 1911 is also my bedside gun, but I don't carry one, simply because I've never found one well suited for my year-round EDC. The balance of size, weight, capacity, and overall features, I've never found one that checked all my boxes. Now, the subject matter of EDC is a contentious place. There's an argument that a carry gun should be as inexpensive as possible in the event you're in a self-defense shooting. At least your now confiscated gun wasn't expensive. Well, amigo, allow me to shit all over that philosophy. This is the Nighthawk Treasurer, and it's my new EDC gun.
One time I got a little infection in one of my nuts.
Chlamydia.
It was like a size of an orange. My mom had to take me to the hospital.
Okay, everybody, welcome. It is thrilling to have you here as we talk about carry guns. This is gonna be kind of a meaty episode today, lot to talk about as we break down the Nighthawk Treasurer. But before we get into that, I have good news for the audience at home, which is we have new sponsors for the channel.
Ooh.
This is exciting for us.
Super
cool. We always seek out relationships that we're going to believe are going to be good and long-term. And
mutually beneficial.
Yeah, and we've been fortunate. There's a shop that's actually based out of Utah. They ship all over the place, but it's called Peace of Mind Guns. I believe they just go by Peace of Mind on IG, or just if you search Peace of Mind Guns, it'll pop up.
You'll be all right.
But
basically high-end sort of boutique shop, and they basically, his name's Mason, he carries all the kind of stuff that we talk about.
Yeah, like, I don't know, Langdon P30?
They carry Langdon, the Langdon series guns. They also are a Nighthawk dealer. They, like, this is cool for us, because it's like a shop that's like, hey, we really like the stuff you guys talk about in videos, and we're like, well, we like the stuff you guys carry. It happens to be the same thing, so let's make some magic happen. So,
he's a big suppressor guy, too.
Yeah, so. Big suppressor, NFA, all that CGS, kind of stuff. You know? So you can go check out Peace Mind Guns, great customer service. Hell, we all know them. Buster owns stuff from them, like, it's, you know, great shop.
Yep.
Great job. So anyway, and if you call, tell them the Syndicate boys sent you, and I don't know, we'll throw you a sticker or some shit. Don't hold them to that, but I'm throwing out a wild card idea. Mason, please don't fire us. For, like on tip video number one.
And done. Merchandise. We got hats. We got shirts. Get on the website, because all you assholes ask for stuff. Now that we have it, go buy it.
Yeah, go buy it, dickhead.
Love you guys.
Okay, let's get into it. We love you guys. You know that.
Yeah, we know.
A couple quick disclaimers. So, relationship with Nighthawk. So, here's the deal, guys. This is my gun that I paid for. So,
yeah,
pretty straightforward. I do know them. I like them. So, am I truly unbiased? No, I've got a you know, we're not like best friends
that
drink together every night, but it's like I do know them. I think fondly of them, but I did buy this gun. So, you know, I can be pretty unbiased because I bought the gun. Let's get into this. And like I said, this will be kind of a meaty video today. So just kind of, you know, hang out, pour yourself a drink. Hopefully our drink.
Hopefully.
So I have not historically carried a 1911, right?
Which is like...
Yeah.
1911 Syndicate, and you don't even fucking carry one.
Right. And let me tell you why.
Is it the girlish frame, or?
No. I've got the structure to be able to carry anything. I can carry Desert Eagle if I wanted to, right?
Eesh.
But here's the deal. 1911s are based around 45 ACP and a 5-inch design, okay?
Okay.
That's not what I want to carry. That, frankly, is too much for me to carry. Like a 5-inch all-steel gun, it's like, that's just too much for me. You know, you're
little bigger.
Yeah. A
little bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just, you know, like 100 pounds.
Hefty. Hefty.
It's like, you know, it's like when my family used to call me husky, and I'm like, that's just a nice way of saying you're fat ass.
Right. So you probably get away with it. But so here's the deal. What I seek in a 1911 carry gun is 9mm and an officer size gun.
Which
officer
is 4 1/4?
No, that's commander.
So, officer would be 3 3/4.
Roughly, yeah. Very, very close, right? So
getting it.
This is an officer size gun. Now, the reason, that the problem is that officer 1911s are not historically known to run very well. And in 9mm, because again, based around 5-inch and 45.
Yeah.
So we shorten it down to an officer frame, slide, everything. And then 9mm, you're like, dude, that's a recipe for problems. So when it came time to do that, I'm like, look, Nighthawk has a few models that pique my interest.
Okay.
And I will get into why I did this and some of the design features, all that kind of stuff. I'm going to assume that everyone knows who Nighthawk is here. One gunsmith
sure.
Is their whole philosophy. So basically, yeah. One dude builds this gun. So here you go. I'm going to pass that to you.
Thank you.
So they stamped their initials underneath the grips on the frame. So it's kind of cool. Like, you know who actually built your gun, and he built it start to finish. It's a really nice little touch there. So breakdown of the Treasurer. It's an observation that I had going through this, because I believe this is the first gun I've ever actually ordered from Nighthawk. Like, I've bought other Nighthawks off the shelf, but I ordered this one. So this was made to spec based on what I wanted. And what's cool about Nighthawk is I believe that you can look through their catalog, if you will,
sure.
Their roster of guns that they make, and you can find a model that's probably going to check 80% of your boxes.
Okay.
Where you're like, okay, that one does about 80% of what I'm looking for. The Nighthawk custom part is where you take on that other 20%.
Oh, okay.
So for me as a lefty, right, I'm looking for certain things, ambidextrous safeties.
Which this has.
Yeah. You know, and I mean, really, that's my primary feature that I need, if I'm being honest, from a functional standpoint. But there's other things I want, whether magwells, IOS cuts. So that the 20% is what you get in the customization. But the base gun for me is like, dude, that's almost perfect. I just need that little bit of, like, I want a checkering underneath here, shit like okay. That, right? And we'll kind of get into that. Treasurer came out February 2022, so it's a relatively new offering for them. It's part of their Boardroom series. Now, I didn't know what this was until I asked them. I'm like, I hear the term, but I don't actually know what it means.
I think I know. So it's a series because they have a counselor. Is that part of the
counselor
Boardroom series?
No.
Oh, I just thought boardroom counselor. I'll shut up.
Go ahead. Here's what it is, because I didn't know until I was like, so what is that?
Yeah.
So this exact gun, they make it an officer size called the Treasurer. They make it in a Commander, which is your 4 1/4. That's called the Vice President. They make it in a 5 inch. That's called the President. They make it in a 6 inch. It's called the Chairman.
Okay.
So it's the same gun, aesthetically. It's the same gun. Which link do you want it in? It's the boardroom series. So you could have four of these. They all basically look the
all
same
part of the series
thing. It's the same gun. It's just in different links and configurations, right? So that's what the boardroom series is. Like I said, this is officer. It's chambered in 9mm. And one of the first things that I do when I get a new 1911, because a 1911 and even 2011, but especially a 1911, is a classy gun for a classy gentleman. And one of the first things I'm going to look at is the fit and finish of the gun. And you will notice if you drop that slide and just kind of tug around on it, like,
there's no wiggle.
Tight gun.
To the point where I landed yesterday, first thing we did, we got to your house, and you're like, hey, we got to disassemble this thing.
Yeah.
And it's so tight. This is not a knock on Nighthawk. It's so tight, I need three hands. So I had to like hold it and finagle it, and we had to punch it out, right?
Yeah, so the slide stop is so stiff. Not a word that I like saying to another man, but the slide stop is so stiff.
Not really girthy, just stiff.
Yeah, it's stiff that someone had to hold the slide back while someone else punched it. Now, I would actually say that that's a little bit, it's actually my only criticism with the gun, if I'm being honest.
Oh, really?
Okay. Which is that, hey, man, that slide stop is such a bitch right now that like I actually needed to punch in a second set of hands in order for someone to punch it while someone held it in the right spot.
Question though.
Yeah.
Not knowing as much as you do and other 1911 fans, just go with me on this. Is that maybe they make it a little too tight, so after you've shot it and worn it in a little bit, you're good to go? Or
I suspect there'll be a little bit of a break-in period where that will maybe ever so slightly loosen up. I wouldn't expect by very much, if
maybe
any.
That's the point, right?
It could be.
Okay.
It could
I don't
be.
Know anything. I'm just spitballing.
You know, they definitely typically have a break-in period on very tight-fit guns like that. It's also where you get some of the accuracy, and it's just some of the wow factor of like, wow, man, that thing really has a tight tolerance.
Yeah.
Which on a carry gun, you could debate, because maybe you want a little slop because of a carry gun. But we'll kind of get into that. So here's some specs for you.
It's very aesthetically pleasing.
Very much. So that gun, I have, I typically carry a SIG 365 XL or a Glock 48. So if you look at the profile of that compared to that Glock 48, they are virtually identical in their profile.
Oh, wow.
I mean, basically identical.
It's going to be hard to, like, get this on the camera.
Yeah, no big deal.
But, like,
take our word for it. A Glock 48 and that Treasurer are basically the exact same size. So that's the exact same profile as a Glock 48, which is the size that a guy my size can roughly get away with carrying. Now, there's going to be, I'm speaking a little out of term there. Some dudes can get away with crazy shit. Like, for me, that is my sweet spot of a size for a carry gun, right?
Sure.
Now, weight-wise, obviously, it is going to be a little bit heavier. So the Glock 48 with no red dot and unloaded comes in at 21 ounces. So with a dot, it'd probably be about 24. Okay. So probably about 24 ounces, maybe even 22, but 22 to 24, call it. The Treasurer with the dot is 35 ounces.
Okay.
So it's heavier, but we're talking by about 10 ounces.
Okay.
Right? Call it about 10 ounces heavier, which is not significant. I think most people, when they pick up that gun, are going to think pretty lightweight, actually.
I think it's more than wieldable. Like it's...
And here's why.
It's right.
Right, and here's why. So one of the options that they have is, would you like to do an aluminum frame or a steel frame? So we opted for an aluminum frame on this. And
to shave some weight.
7 ounces. 7 ounces is pretty significant.
Okay.
Yeah. So 7 ounce weight savings is actually pretty significant in my opinion, especially on a carry gun where this is going to be on you and you are going to feel that weight.
Sure.
So I really like that feature. It's not going to be as robust as steel would be, but again, on a carry gun, look, it's probably not the gun you're going to use and abuse to a point of oblivion. You know, it's like, it's carry gun.
You stay proficient with it.
Stay
you get
proficient.
The reps in.
Yeah. But it's like, it's not your 50,000 round gun, you know? So to me, the weight is really solid. That was one of the upgrades that I made to that was the aluminum frame. So it's 8+1 on the capacity. Now, that's going to be a criticism from some people. They're going to be like, oh man, you're really sacrificing capacity on your carry gun. Okay. Well, you're not wrong, but I talked to some instructors and I just said, hey, look, you guys probably hear the reports more than anyone, like average rounds in a self-defense shooting and 3 to 5. You know,
and
is
that's
from
both parties, correct?
Well, I was told 3 to 5, so I'm going to just say for the primary, you know, for the dude defending himself.
Cool.
So call it 3 to 5 rounds. So look, statistically, guys, 8+1 is enough capacity. Would I love to have 50 rounds? I'd love to. I don't want the weight of it, and I think it's unnecessary in 99% of shootings that are going to happen. So yes, I sacrificed capacity, but what I was doing was sacrificing capacity for something that I shoot way better. Because the truth is, I shoot that gun way better than I'm going to shoot a Glock 48.
Yeah, and for like a little gun, dude, it shoots very nice.
Very shootable.
Yeah.
Very, very.
After a couple mags, you're like, so what do you think? And like, I'm pleasantly surprised with how this gun shoots. So.
Absolutely.
Points well, recoils well, all of it.
Yeah. So also on the frame, so we got a one piece mag well and mainspring housing. So this guy, right,
all
that's
one
happening
piece
back there, that is all one piece of billet, right? And it's very, very nicely done. The mag well does help aid in reloads quite a bit, actually, even though it's a minimalist mag well. Actually makes quite a bit of difference.
Well, you can see the scratch marks where it's helped feed the mags in.
Yeah, because you know, I treat my guns like guns. Yeah. You know? It's like it's gonna get shot. I also like this little bevel that they have at the back of that.
That's for carry specifically.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's that little like kind of bobtail just to alleviate some of that sharp point that would typically print.
Yeah, there'd be kind of two 90 degree angles right here. I only know this because the SIG 1911 that I used to have that I carried, they would have that feature because it's rounded, easier for carrying.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is a really nice feature. You know, again, this is a purpose-built carry gun. Like, this is a proper 1911 carry gun. So they did a very, very nice job on that. We did checkering on the front strap and the mainspring housing. Also checkering underneath the trigger guard there, which is all the same. I can't remember the lines per inch. If you ever see LPI in 1911 world, that stands for lines per inch. Different, numbers, if you will, based on how aggressive or not aggressive you want it to be. This is kind of right in that sweet spot. The checkering underneath the trigger guard is very, very nicely done.
Very nice.
So they did quite a nice job.
Good little
on
index
that
point.
Yep. Grips are from rail scales. It was a point of concern that I had.
That it was too grippy?
I thought it was going to be a problem against the old tummy. You
can
know
I rub
saying?
It on my tummy to see?
Yeah. Yeah. Fuck it. Why not?
All right.
Yeah. Send it. Send it. Go ahead.
Let me try this side real quick.
So if
I gotta do it one more time.
If you do that,
it's not terrible.
It's probably gonna be obnoxious. When
there's
you
some
actually
skin
carry
and hair
it
on there, sorry.
Yeah, but what winds up contacting your body a lot winds up being, you know, back here and some of this, but it's like it doesn't wind up. I thought it was just gonna be too aggressive. And it's not. Somehow it's like a bit of it's a bit impressive to be honest, because I really thought those grips are gonna be a nightmare and I was gonna change them out.
Huh. Yeah.
And they're solid and very grippy. Like they're very, very grippy. Like if you're covered in blood, oil, lube, anything like that, and you have to grab this gun, it's not going anywhere, guys. Like you can be as oily as you want.
It's good to know.
So just kind of food for thought, you know. Ambi safety, very nicely fit to the gun. Yeah. It's in that perfect sweet spot of retention where it's like, look, I have very positive
down
on and off.
Yeah.
But also not like loose enough that I'm accidentally gonna nudge it up. Like very, very nicely fit, which I would expect from Nighthawk, especially of a gun of that price. Trigger, excellent. It is in about the sweet spot of where I would like my trigger to be, especially on a carry gun.
Four and a half?
I think it's probably about 3.5.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's probably about 3.5.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't do the Lyman pull gauge thing just because I don't fucking care that much.
people hate
like it's
that.
Either like good or it's not good, you know? Like I'll know if it's too light because I'll just be like, yeah, it's too light for me. It's about 3.5, very crisp. Very, very nicely done. Again, what I would expect from Nighthawk. No rail, that would be a complaint from some people. Hey, it's a non-railed gun, so what do you do with your weapon light? Look, I typically run a handheld anyway.
Which
is what I do.
I've heard an argument that that's how you should do it anyways. Because you don't always need to point the gun at the thing you need a light at.
Hey, correct.
Right?
You know, it's like, oh shit, I'm just in a dark place and I need to get out. My only light's on my gun. It's like, well, have fun when, you know, the movie theater calls cops on you.
Right.
So the slide, just kind of breaking that down, is all dehorned. What I mean by that is very...
No sharp edges.
No sharp edges anywhere. Very nice. And again, a lot of what you're paying for in a high-end 1911 is that refinement, right? And that, you know, dehorning, if you will, of all those sharp edges, that's a lot of what you're getting. So very, very nice. No hot spots. The IOS is fantastic. For those of you that don't know, the IOS is Nighthawk's Interchangeable Optic System. We have a video we did on a Firehawk. You can go watch that because I'm pretty sure we show how the IOS works.
Yeah.
But here's the deal. I've got three different ways that I can run this. I have an iron sight plate. Here's how it works, guys. Very, very simple. You take a little Allen key they send you with it. You do a little quarter turn on this little thing. Then you push the bar through. This plate comes comes out. Like it
with
it,
the optic mounted to it. It's all one thing now.
This optic is mounted to the plate. So what's cool is then I can slap on an iron plate, throw the bar through, tighten this down real quick, and it's like it's about a 30-second swap, and now I got an iron sight gun. If I want to put my dot back on, because it didn't leave the plate, it stays zeroed.
Yeah.
So it's like you don't lose zero.
Well, and they I've got a wedge cut underneath it, maintains that also.
It's really nice. And so I've got three plates actually for this. I've got the iron sight plate. This one's cut for an RMSC, and then I've got an RMR one. So I can run three different versions of this
thing. That's cool.
I can run an RMR or a Holosun like 507C. Running the Holosun EPS, we will talk about that in a different video probably in the next couple weeks.
Yeah.
So stay tuned to that. It is, in my opinion, it's regardless of price, that is the dot that I like and want on that gun.
Cool.
That dot is money, okay? So spoiler alert, probably a good video coming out on the EPS.
And then you got a blacked out rear iron sight with a white dot tritium insert front sight.
Yeah, so. Yep. Super cool. 3.8 inch bull barrel. So there's your barrel length. So 3.8 inch bull barrel, so there's no bushing, which I typically prefer. Just, you know.
Good looking bull barrel.
Just me.
Right?
It's titanium nitride. The titanium nitride is mainly for lubricity. And just durability.
And looking really fucking
cool. And looking dope. You know, they always look as an all black gun with a little bit of TIN.
A little bit of flare, right?
Always looks good.
Sure.
The barrel hood is fluted. So you'll notice these little flutes up here. That for me is mostly aesthetic. I just think it looks very nice. And it is flush crowned. So it's a very, very nice crowned at the end of that muzzle.
Yeah.
You probably just pointed at the camera. No one's behind the
No one's behind the camera, just so viewers.
Or we might have B-roll of it anyway. Yeah. But very, very nicely crowned barrel. Great. Serrations, nice, grippy. They do everything that I would like them to do. Like they're nice. Like
good for
they're
little
actually
checks.
Really in the sweet spot of like how aggressive I would like some serrations to be. Very nicely done on that. They do have some like you know what you call it, lightning cuts or whatever you want to call them. Essentially a couple little cutouts both on the little front of the slide. So you get that little pop of titanium nitride. Also lighten the slide a little bit, also the one up top. I could argue that on a carry gun, hey, keep the extra little bit of weight in there just to prevent anything from debris or anything. Anything that's
nut
in this area.
Or,
nut, I was going to suggest nut juice for getting into your slide. Although that might add some lubricity to the whole thing. So I don't know. You could argue it either way. Nighthawk's probably already been down this rabbit hole and you guys probably did this because you preferred the nut juice. So, it's really, we'll just move on. We'll just move on from that section of the, okay. So, DLC finish, very nicely done. You will notice there's slightly different shades on the frame and the slide.
Yeah.
That's just because one's aluminum, the other's
steel.
So
metal's gonna look different when it's
finished. They told me that. They were like, hey, just understand like they're gonna be slightly different shades, and I actually think it looks cool. So not a problem for me. Talk price real quick. Base price on the gun's $4,600 and as configured, $5,870. So is this the cheapest carry gun in the world? No, sir.
It's not.
I don't. I'm busy, bro. I'm a busy dog. So I wouldn't call it the most inexpensive carry gun that you could get. But, well, I'm going to go ahead and just talk about this real quick. So there's two schools of thought on this. One is the guys that I don't understand who say, well, I carry the cheapest carry gun that I can because if I'm in a shooting and it gets confiscated, at least I was only out $199 goddamn dollars.
Here's my excuse. My life is not worth a lot. It is worth more than $199.
I'm glad you changed it to life.
Whoops.
So
I'd rather pay for a little more pricey gun that I know is reliable. And like if I'm alive and evidence keeps the gun forever, hey bro, you're alive. Now little tough to get to. However, you're a Gucci guy that likes Gucci shit, so does it really matter? Is it reliable and accurate?
Yes, very.
Okay, then I don't.
And here's the thing: I shoot it better than I'm going to shoot a striker fire gun because this is what I train with. And I go, look, man, if the bit of performance edge that I get on a better gun is the difference in hypothetically maybe me winning a gunfight, and I go home, take the fucking gun.
Yeah.
Take the gun, dude. I get to go home tonight. Or probably go to a holding cell for the night. But, you know, like, hey, if I'm alive and my kit played a factor in me getting to go home, take the gun.
Sure.
And again, if it's a legally justified shooting, I'm going to wind up getting the gun back. So what's the difference?
Might be a year, which I don't really care, okay? And then some, like say you have concealed carry insurance, mm-hmm. some insurances, again, if it's a legally justified, you're in the clear.
Yes.
They will put a certain amount towards your next gun.
Yeah.
Well, so we'll, like,
we'll bring that up right at the end of the video, but that's true. Yeah. Our new partnership we've got with
that's
Firearms
why.
Legal Protection.
See I what I did there?
Wink, wink, nod, nod.
See
but
what
hey,
I did there?
You know, they'll cover up to $1,000 on your carry gun if it gets confiscated in a legally justified shooting. It's like, oh, that's kind of cool. No, it's not going to cover
it's
that.
A sixth of the
yeah,
price
it covers
of the gun.
One-sixth of the price of the gun, you know? Tax not included. So here's the deal. Let me borrow those two things from you real quick, Buster. So a real quick rundown of EDC gear, just because sometimes in an EDC-related video like this, people
sure.
are kind of the recap of what do you carry. All right, so mine's super simple, and I think we're pretty similar on this. So first things first, belt. So these belts, both the one that I've got on is and this one are from Sagara Gear.
Same.
And so I usually wear their inner belt that is the thin, light Velcro inner belt.
That's what I wear.
I typically carry this. Today I'm wearing the emissary belt just because at a range, typically I like a little more rigidity.
A little more stiffness.
Yeah. You know, don't look at me and say that. But this is what we use day to day. I think I even wrote it down. Did I write it down? Because I know we had a promo code on that 1911 Syndicate, right? And it's 10% off that you get on belts
on Sagara.
Yeah. We did a couple reviews on these a while back, so you can go back and you
best
can look
belts
at
on
that.
The market.
But so. Good belts, never had an issue with them. Good customer service, all that kind of
great
shit,
company,
right? That can rest over there. Knife, you can't buy these, but just so you know what the knife itself is, these are from Nate Summers, local bladesmith in Utah. Super aggressive bug that just
dude, that grasshopper slapped you in the face.
Son of a bitch, I would have just yanked this.
Yeeted that dude.
Yeah. So I carry a fixed blade. I prefer carrying a fixed blade. I've gotten used to it, and to me now that is how I rock it. So this sort of karambit dagger style thing from Nate Summers, this is what I carry. Beyond that, the holster that got worked up for the Nighthawk, this is from RDR Gear here in Salt Lake.
Senior Jefe.
Yeah, he does a cool mod on the 1911 rigs where this little tab right here is actually where the safety index is.
Yeah, I saw that.
So that the thumb safety actually can't come off when it's slide up and
when
it's
you're
in your holster.
Carrying concealed.
Yeah. So it'll actually lock into that index.
Ah, that's cool.
Yeah, so yeah, it is a nice mod and safety perspective wise. I guess you could.
You can overpower it, but this is against your body and it's not going to happen.
No, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. So that's that. Final thoughts on the gun, guys. How does the gun shoot? Because at the end of the day, that is, of course, one thing that's very important.
Here you go.
In my opinion, it shoots surprisingly good.
Yeah.
I thought it was going to be a lot snappier than it is because, again, aluminum frame and an overall smaller footprint of a gun. I thought that this was going to be on the snappy side, and it's really not. It's very, very nice to shoot to a point that it actually took me by surprise.
Well, driving here yesterday when you picked me up from the airport, we were talking about it, and you're like, dude, I think you might be a little impressed with how this gun shoots. And I'm like, sure, Jake, yada, yada, yada. Today's the first day I shot it. And dude, I will say, with our witnesses here, mm-hmm. the one wearing the Canes hat too, my man.
Fuck you.
It does shoot very nice for a small gun. You did a good job. Your shirt, your Cane shirt too is crispy, gets an extra bag of rice.
Yeah, when you buy that whole outfit for $16, it actually says something about the franchise. Hate to break it to you. Doesn't say something about you. It says something about them. Because it's dog shit cheap apparel.
Why are you getting so aggressive right now?
Fuck both of you. Like, stupid Cane's shirt. We apologize to all the families at home. The dot's very easy to track under recoil, which is a big point. How is this returning to zero under recoil? And very, very nicely. I will also say this. I was surprised that this gun did not have a break-in period.
Tell me to hold that.
I truthfully thought on a gun that tight, like there's going to be 300 to 500 rounds of like, we're going to have some malfunctions we got to work through. It's like, it's all good. It's an understandable thing on a custom, you know, gun like that that's hand fit. There's probably going to be some break-ins and stuff like that. Not a single damn malfunction has happened on that. And why it's of note is because last night was the first time that I've taken it apart and cleaned it. So
and
as it
lubed
came
it.
Yes, it has had no cleaning, no oil, no nothing. It has run since day one for the last maybe 5 weeks ago I got it. In its configuration that it came, no oil, no nothing added. And it's like the fact that that gun with that tight of tolerance has been that reliable is quite impressive. Very,
says a
very
lot.
Impressive. Yeah, it says a lot. So I'm really happy with it, guys. Like I said, hey, look, this is my new carry gun. This will be the thing that's on me all the time. And that's that. And cool. A message that we would leave you with, because it's another new partnership that we've got, is whether or not you're going to carry a $6,000 carry gun, it would be advised that if you are going to carry a gun, you would have some carry insurance.
Yeah.
Well, what, you know, it's heavy.
You would have some carry insurance. Yeah, sorry to interrupt you.
You deal with this.
Yeah.
Now, I know some of you at home are just like, here we go. But telling you guys, I would actually consider this shit, like, yeah. I kind of had a change of heart on this, you know, over the past little bit here. So
especially the last couple years.
Yeah. There's a company that we're working with now called Firearms Legal Protection. It's a service that they offer. Really good rates. Not going to talk about competitors, but especially compared to some competitors, actually really good offering for a very, very good price.
Yeah.
And the good news for you guys is that there's a code. It's just 1911. We'll link it below, but there's also just a code you can plug in, 1911, and it saves you, like, pretty good percent, probably like 30% off or something like
cool.
that. So would recommend check that out. And that pretty much wraps this bad boy up.
Yeah, cool. I don't have anything to add because this is your gun.